hits, your head goes up in the air.
Here we are. It's still season three, now episode five, from your loyal Digital Press podcast team, Frankie, Mike, Greg, and Joe. Holiday season, we're in the mood for gaming again, and we got a bunch of 2600 games in front of us that you might be able to see from a distance. The topic, which actually came up in a conversation last night, was what do you think is the most technologically advanced Atari 2600 game. This was came from a specific person that was in the store last night, and kind of got us to thinking. And as we conversed and argued a little bit about it, we came to some resolution and definitely had some examples that we wanted to share. So,
and we're talking about commercial releases. We're not talking about modern homebrew.
That's exactly the way the conversation started. Well, now you look at some of the homebrew things. Like the guys have 32K to work with.
Yeah. Well, we're also not counting the StarPath.
Yeah. No, it had to be an actual cartridge release
during
back
the era.
In the day. So who wants to start? We got a few games up here that all look pretty technologically advanced.
Well, whenever this topic ever comes up, for me, the first game I immediately go to is Solaris. It was late generation 2600. It was during the 2600 Junior marketing campaign, the Red Box era. It was a part of the 2600 Junior advertisement, the fun is back, the 2600 from Atari, and it just has beautiful scrolling effects. You know, your starship flies along the surface of planets. You know, if you asked somebody, do you think this is an Atari 2600 game, and they were unfamiliar with it, they'd probably say, no, it probably looks like a 5200 or a 7800 game.
It is. It is that good that it could pass for something a little higher gen.
So I just looked up the history, and Solaris was this program by Douglas Neubauer. It was supposed to be, it became like a follow-up to Star Raiders. This is where it gets very confusing with Atari. It was essentially supposed to be a follow-up to Star Raiders, but Atari actually put out a game called Star Raiders 2, which was actually originally the last Starfighter. But they lost the license or whatever with that and renamed it Star Raiders 2, which I don't think ever came out either, as far as I know. So it's very confusing, but there you have it.
Yeah. I mean, just slap a different title on it, release it.
It kind of has a, from what it's been a while since I played it, but I do recall it being a sort of a combination of Star Raiders with the grid and being able to go from place to place in the galaxy to the ground, the action levels being sort of like Moonsweeper. It always reminded me of that, the sort of scrolling planets that were like the planet surface that was scrolling by you, and you know, you could pick things up and shoot as you were on the ground. Pretty cool game.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Great visual effects, very super smooth. Doesn't suffer from flicker or you know, object limits on screen or anything like that. It's great.
Very polished.
Yep, highly polished.
Mike jumped right to Defender when we brought this up.
Yeah, I think, you know, to me, that part of the charm of this is that this port is that it maintains that speed. You know, it's like, I mean, you know, Defender is a hectic game, very, very fast. You know, and this is a decent port. It's got the, you know, the speed, and it's got like the flickering, like multicolor, like lasers. You know, like that's always nice, like very bright lasers.
Your ship, you know, like disintegrating, and it's in like a massive firework type explosion.
Yeah, this is a really well put together adaptation, I think.
It also has some of the best, most ridiculous
airbrushed,
out of place box art ever.
All very, very memorable.
Yeah, all those.
It's very common
first-gen color box 2600 games with the watercolor paintings are great.
They're way over the top. What's going on?
Now, I've heard that a lot of the programmers back then were against that because they felt like the customer was being hoodwinked and that they were their like they felt like they couldn't their games couldn't live up to the standard. I mean, last time we were joking about Super Breakout. And the fact that
we have a picture of it up on one of our
yeah. So, of you know, it's got these astronaut guys like shooting lasers and stuff, and in the reality the game was just like a brick. It was just a block going back and forth and shooting a ball.
Doesn't the Video Game History Museum own the original watercolor for Warlords?
I think it is the original watercolor. That is, it has been disputed as to whether or not that is an original or not. John Hardy won't like to hear that again, but it's been disputed. I'm not so sure it's been proven either way, but it's a full-size, big, framed print of the front of the Warlords 2600 box.
Well, even if not original, it was certainly production art from that era, probably professionally.
And old. It's not recently reproduced.
No,
so.
Not at all.
I guess like that era, it was very common to try to like ape the art that would you would see maybe like for an Arthur C. Clarke novel or something like that. You know, it's like that kind of.
Yeah, I mean they were essentially like movie like
Drew Struzan attempt to duplicate
Drew Struzan Indiana Jones poster. Every Atari game wanted to be Raiders of the Lost Ark with the action character with sweeping, arm and. Movement, like the painting looked like it was moving. Yeah. Essentially, all of those games, even a game like Super Breakout, the astronaut has like speed lines coming off of him as he's flying through space.
Use your imagination.
Another game I want to, we don't have it here, but Gyrus, that's another game that has. It's again, it doesn't look anything like the arcade, but it plays. It's close enough. It plays similar enough
to the arcade.
It's quick. It's got that, you circle around real fast, and it's got nice music. That stands out on that system.
One of the few games that has a running soundtrack throughout.
Pitfall 2.
Pitfall 2 on that, yeah.
Yeah, you compare that to even the and Defender as well. If you compare it to the higher versions on the ColecoVision or Atari 5200, both games. Obviously, the graphics were better on those systems, but the control on them were terrible. Like Defender, I know 5200. Maybe I'm just
that's a typical problem though with the 5200.
It's very difficult to play that game on the 5200 with that stupid
that analog
joystick.
Control. It did. Yeah, I mean, a game that moved as fast as Defender. Yeah. The time it takes for that half a second.
Excuse yourself.
Is that Pitfall Harry in your pants, or are you just happy to see me?
The 2600. I mean, it was you had those graphics in some of those games, but obviously you had the better controls. So,
Another Parker Brothers game, which Gyrus was published by Parker Brothers, even though it was a Konami title in arcades. Qbert was excellent, on 2600. It retained, all the colors, which were so important in the arcade version, it wasn't as monochromatic as some of the earlier 2600 games. And it plays great, too, on 2600.
I have two comments based on both of those choices. One, I don't think Qbert was a good port.
You don't think it's a good port?
I didn't like it back then. I thought it was very, very ugly, as a matter of fact. Hmm. And the thing that really bothered me about it, and I'm sure it had something to do with, the way they had to map the graphics, but every time the screen would load up, there's this giant earthquake barrier in the middle of the screen, like some blocks are separated from the rest of the blocks, right? If you look, probably even in a screenshot of it, you can see it because it's on every board. And I always was like, well, why do those have to be separated like that? Am I jumping further across? Couldn't they get them to actually play?
Yeah.
I mean, it's for the 2600. It's a pretty good game, but I wouldn't have put that in my list of good. Or technological.
Maybe I have rose-colored goggles on for that one. I don't know.
If you ever played the ColecoVision version, all of a sudden it's like, well, that, now everything looks exactly like it's supposed to.
The ColecoVision looks more like the arcade version.
I wasn't crazy about that. And with Defender, I never thought that was a good-looking game at all, but I'd give you technologically advanced because it was able to do all of those elements of the game are still there. They've somehow managed to get them all in there, even though there's only one button. Yeah. And that whole thing with what made the arcade game so special is that there's things going on that aren't on your screen.
Yes.
Which is, kind of cool. Yeah. And anytime you had that happening in a video game at home, it was was really off. But I didn't think... I'm kind of surprised that you think the graphics on that were good. Like, I always thought you hit something and it just pretty much just disappears. It just disappears. There's no real explosion. Your ship disappears.
I guess, you know, I'm one of the colors. The colors.
Yeah,
you know,
it's very colorful. I'll give you that.
You know? I wouldn't have chosen it either.
It's technologically advanced for sure, but yeah, I don't know about the graphics. So, what else you got?
We have Crossbow, another late-gen.
I chose Crossbow,
Red Box.
Yeah. I chose that. I'm pretty sure that every level of the arcade game's on the 2600 version of Crossbow, which is pretty remarkable. They could have gone the route of most of the arcade ports and said, well, we'll get the important ones in there, and you know that's all people will really remember. They'll care about the desert and the jungle, but I'm pretty sure they're all
you can get to the castle. There. You have to collect all the items on your path in Crossbow.
I'm not sure what's missing from the game, but the levels are there.
Collect them.
Maybe some of the characters are missing, or you know, I'm sure it's not 100%.
Oh, there's a lot of characters in Crossbow. Yeah. On each level, you get at least two.
Like to point out that some really, really off-model box art. It's like hands, yeah, like giant
weird
hands.
Weird stuff going on there.
Is that the arcade?
That might be the actual label on the side of the Exidy machine. I believe
it
that
might be.
That's the side art from the cabinet.
I liked it. That was one of those that I kind of thought was. I was surprised they were able to get that much into a game for 2600. And, you know, again, maybe not graphically the greatest game. So nothing beats Solaris for graphics. Mm. But as far as cramming so much into a small space...
Crossbow is one of those games for 2600 that I was actually unaware of until the internet that it came out. I mean, I was a big 2600 fan growing up, and as a kid, I never saw it at retail. It just, for some reason, it escaped me, and there's a few games like that. Like, I never knew Xenophobe was published on 7800, you know, until years later when I found new old stock listings on eBay. I was like... You know, and it's better than the NES version. It's more arcade accurate. But, yeah, Crossbow.
Low standard.
I'm a fan, huge fan of the Exidy arcade crossbow shooter type games. That and Cheyenne and Combat, Whodunit. So, and to see it on 2600, I was like, it's gotta be crap. And then I played it, and, you know, you control it with the joystick. There's no, you don't have a light gun or anything, but it works. It's a good conversion.
I would say I'm thinking of some platform games. I'll leave one for you because I know you'll mention it. But Pitfall 2, I thought was pretty... I mean, you know what? It wasn't that much more improved graphically than Pitfall 1.
You know what? I think it actually is. If you look at them side by side, they really do...
Not sprite-wise.
No, but I mean, I think that it's noticeable. I think it is a noticeable improvement.
Yeah, so, well, in Pitfall 2, you had, like
the swimming,
subterranean levels, and it was really
a big game.
It's a huge maze. Very impressive game for 2600. And also, just some other Activision I'm thinking about. Obviously, River Raid, which is one of my favorites. Even though it's simplistic, I thought graphically that, you know, that... They were able to make enough of the ships and the helicopters and everything look appropriate, so it works. And I think you know, even Moctezuma's Revenge, even though it looked much better on the 5200 and ColecoVision, but I thought it still looked really good on the 2600.
And again, there's so many screens in it.
Yeah.
It seems like how did they get all of that together? So many things going on.
Yeah, and I think not just, you know, in this discussion, graphics doesn't mean that it's impressive alone. If you can fit all that stuff in a game, I mean, that's impressive.
Yep.
Especially, you know, how many retail games were larger than 8K?
No.
I'd be lying if I told
you. Anything.
Yeah, right. None. I don't think any.
Yeah.
I don't know if by this point maybe they had gotten up to 16, but I'm not even sure if they did. Be easy enough to check, you know, look on your emulator's BIN file and see what the size is.
But. Yeah, I think it's difficult to argue in general that Activision didn't have some of the best artists, like graphic, you know, people making the games that knew how to work artistically with the limitations of the 2600. Those were really the first 2600 games where the sky wasn't just one color.
Right.
You know, they'd make a gradient effect. Mm-hmm. With they'd take a blue and they'd make it go dark blue to middle blue to light blue, as the sky, you know.
And they did scrolling and River Raid and in the game that I'm sure you'll mention, the four letters. Come on, you know what game it is.
Tron.
No.
A 2600 game that
from
I was
Activision.
Going to mention?
Yes, Activision.
Oink?
No. Platforming game. You know, the guy's floating.
You gotta say it.
He's floating. Hero. Hero.
Oh, Hero. All right. That's right. We talked about it last night.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. But I'm just saying, like...
Yeah.
But I think the problem for Activision was, even though they did some of those great games, they kind of fell off the map there right after the crash, and that was it. I think they could have done some even more impressive games for the 2600, but they just... Well, because you see it today. I mean, I know we're not talking about the homebrew, but there's people now who are... I mean, they've either... accomplished or working on 4K and 8K versions of Donkey Kong, of Pac-Man, of Mario Brothers, you know, so within the quote retail limits of that era, and they're still able to make these games like so unbelievably close to the arcade now, just through, you know, better programming languages, I guess a better compiler or something like that, but just better tools.
Well, they can get done in a very short amount of time. It used to take those guys days and days and days to get
done. And those guys could have done it. Don't get me wrong. Right. They just didn't have the time to do it.
No.
You know, once the game was out, you wouldn't go back and work on it.
Right.
Not getting paid to do that, so.
A couple more honorable mentions. I think Mountain King belongs in that conversation for the same reason. It's just that there's so much in that game that you're playing. And I think Riddle of the Sphinx for iMagic.
A lot of the iMagic games.
Yeah,
similar
a lot of people
to
don't
that
put
Activision.
That in their list of, you know, great games, but it's a good looking game even by today's standards, and the fact that you had all those different items that you could use in the course of a game is pretty very computer-esque, you know, for kind of in that Raiders of the Lost Ark sense where you weren't just throwing rocks at the guy.
In that sense of how did people figure out how to beat it in that era with no internet, no, you know, no message boards or anything.
We beat it.
Yeah.
My buddy Kevin and I beat that game.
I got it secondhand from a neighbor who was basically...
So what's the answer to the riddle?
The riddle of the Sphinx?
Part of
beating
it?
Yeah, I don't remember.
Does it ask you
a question?
I don't
know if I ever beat that. Raiders of the Lost Ark I beat. Okay. I don't remember if I ever beat Riddle of the Sphinx.
I always felt the iMagic games did really good work on with audio. Sounds, just sound effects and stuff like that. I felt like they were pretty accurate with that. It just wasn't the typical... you know, it was something else.
A lot of deep, bassy explosions in iMagic games that would rumble your living room.
Atlantis was a very loud game.
Yeah.
Turn it all the way down.
I think.
How about Tunnel Runner for CBS Electronics? That was another one. I think that had extra memory, an extra memory chip or something inside.
Bank switch or something.
And something was something extra in the cartridge that allowed it to do that quasi 3D thing that you were basically playing Pac-Man in a 3D world.
It was like minor,
pretty complex mazes.
Another late-gen Redbox game, the Real Sports Boxing, I thought was pretty impressive.
Yeah,
the time
that
you
one
could
did
select your
good.
Boxer, and it had a crowd that would cheer you on, and you could actually see them. It wasn't just the giant black marshmallow versus the giant white marshmallow.
So if we had a consensus, would we as a group choose Solaris in case this ever comes up again as a...
It stands out as probably the best looking. Yeah. Like if you're going just by visuals, I think that.
And it also has a lot of that depth and gameplay that you know games like Defender and Montezuma's kind of have.
But I think we covered a good cross section of some of the top contenders.
Our top 10's out there now.
did we have 10?
I don't know if we had 10.
I think we did
15 or something.
Oh yeah. Okay.
Oh well.
All right. We're good.
Yep.
So we're at that segment, my favorite segment, the show and tell segment, where the boys have brought things to show and tell. Let's start with Greg, because Greg has the probably the most complicated one, the most technologically advanced of all of the...
And then I have something that's not technology advanced
at all. Oh, you have multiple
all.
Things to show.
The book. So the first thing is the Sony Pocket Station for the first PlayStation. This only came out in Japan. It was supposed to get a release worldwide, but the Japanese loved it so much, they bought so many of them, that Sony literally could not manufacture enough to keep up with the demand, so they just gave up with the worldwide stuff.
That's
what
story.
I've heard. I don't know.
You don't believe that Sony... Nah, it's too popular here. We can't make more of them.
I don't know why. I mean,
need the money anyway.
The Tamagotchi is the inside of the box. The Tamagotchi stuff sold a lot here, and I thought that those were stupid.
That is the Sony's mascot in Japan.
Oh, yeah, some kind of cat.
Oh, yeah, we should describe these things. That's another thing with the podcast. Yeah, for those listening, describe what we're looking at here.
The retail box here.
So the Pocket Station is very small. It's handheld. It's about the size form of a PlayStation 1 memory card. And in fact, it's a small LCD screen. I'd say it's about maybe an inch and a quarter by an inch and a quarter, monochrome. And it has like a little tassel tied to it. And it has four small buttons that I think are directional, and then one
action button.
Yeah, action button. And the front of it flips up, if I can get it to do it. And basically it reveals the memory card port. And so on a PlayStation, again a Japanese one, you would stick that into the memory card slot, and you would be able to upload the game to this device. So we don't have an exact battery for it, but if we rig it in a way... Is it on?
I don't see anything.
Wait a minute.
There you go.
Don't electrocute yourself.
Okay. What are we looking at here?
A heart. There you go.
It said hello, and then there's a heart. And some other, I don't know. There's something loaded on it already. I don't know what it was.
The date and time, 1999. We've gone back in time. 1999.
It's got... Anyway, so...
So it's the equivalent of the VMU.
Yeah, very similar to the VMU. So I got this on eBay. I really had never heard about this. I'd heard about this vaguely in the past, but I was just fishing around on eBay the other day, and I saw it on there for like $6. And I'm like, yeah, I'll bid on it. I'm sure somebody outbid me for this thing. You know, it came in the box and everything. I don't think it had the manual. That was the only thing.
Ooh, I have a manual.
I saw it in the basement.
Why didn't you take it? You can have it.
Because I thought it came with it. I didn't examine it for close enough. Anyway.
I had an extra one.
So, well, it's in Japanese. Not that it's going to help either.
Yeah, but it's complete now.
True. So, it was like $6. And the guy was also selling, or whoever it was selling the games. I don't even know if I call these games. I don't know what these are. I feel like there's this other guy on YouTube, Adam Karolik, who does this kind of stuff, and he does these unboxing, and there's a lot of things that he gets from imports, and he's just like, I don't know what this is. I don't speak Japanese.
There are a lot of Japanese PlayStation 1 games where that is the only response you can have is, I don't know what this is.
I mean, this thing looks like, let's see here, this game has, there's not even an English label. Usually there's one English label. It's not there, and it looks like there's like a little fish with a school cat with like a like a school person's cap on, a dog, a car.
It's Spectre. It's a ghost.
It says, "Hi, I'm Spectre."
I think it's a guy who's being haunted by hundreds of little black and white digital ghosts.
Now there's some other things here where it says. There's something that says prove, allow, sword, cough, wool. I don't know.
Maybe like an education?
Or a Tamagotchi.
Like one of those entertainment games?
Ghosts.
This one looks cool, Greg.
Yeah.
Pocket Dungeon.
So, I mean, so the guy said it was $6, and then he had these other games. I'm like, well, what do you want for them? Because he didn't sell them. I'm like, now who the heck's going to buy them? And he sold me the whole lot for like $20. Plus the shipping, so I'm like, yeah, why not?
And all of these games are specifically for the Pocket Station?
Yeah, I think so. Because I've never heard of them.
No.
Pocket Dungeon, again, I don't... Oh, boy.
He does not look like a happy
picture
kid.
The back kind of gives you a good, at least you get to see some
there's,
of the graphics.
There's a bat named Buffy. Cool. There's some kind of lizard guy named Gilman.
It's a dungeon crawler.
Oh, boy.
Gilman?
Gee whiz. Sounds I always like wanted to play a dungeon crawler on a 2-inch screen.
Some kid crying on the cover.
This kid here. He's so sad. He's sad that the pocket station has molested
what
him.
What video game puts a picture of a kid crying on it? I don't know. This thing is called Pacqua. Paca. P-A-Q-A. I don't know what that means. It's like some guy sleeping. I don't know. This is very...
Well, Japan was very into life simulation.
Very confusing. And I don't know. Did the games originally come from Japan in like these like kind of outer cases?
I don't think they came like that, but outer, I think they're readily available.
All right.
So they're often shipped in those.
Yeah. And then this one is like a giant case. Mm-hmm. I don't know why it's double-sized. I opened it up. There's no reason for it to be double-sized.
That's pretty typical of Japanese
releases. Yeah. Pocket Mumu. M-U-U-M-U-U. Pocket Mumu. Now, this one actually looks like a PlayStation game because it has, like, full graphics. And there must be something where you load it onto the... Like the VMU did to Dreamcast or certain games. You load it on there. You can do things to, like, level up and increase whatever you're looking to do. And then you... put it back in there, but I don't know. All I know is when I looked on like Wikipedia, I saw many examples of like some like more classic games that you could be downloaded into it, mm-hmm. the Pocket Station. So I don't have a Japanese PlayStation, but
this will work in the US version.
This?
Yes, it will.
How will I get anything on it?
There are certain games that
I know that will,
here.
But how would I get anything on it?
If you have a mod chip in your PlayStation, or if
but
you use a disc, there's loader discs where you can play the Japanese games.
Well, I have the PS2 soft modded, so I think I just use the file browser and load the files directly.
I know that certain American releases that still do have the Pocket Station support built in. I know Final Fantasy VIII does. I think Street Fighter Alpha 3 does. Because they were expecting it to come out here, and so when decided that it didn't, they more or less just left it in there just in case.
I've seen full reports online that people who've used Pocket Stations with their US NTSC Region 1 PlayStations, and they're fully functional. It doesn't. You just have to get past the region lock on the software.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, so I guess should we do this next, the book? So this was a Kickstarter reward, if you might say. This is a Mega Drive, I forget the actual title of this. It's like Mega Drive, Collected Works, sorry. Mega Drive Genesis Collected Works. This, again, was a Kickstarter, and they really, really went way past their goals. And what the great thing about it was, every time they went past another level, they're like, we're going to include X more pages. And so they were pretty clear on it. We go past this, it's going to be this more pages. So this went from, I don't know how many pages it was supposed to be originally, but this thing is massive now. I don't know, what is this? It's probably like 400 pages now. But, so anyway, it comes, it's black, it's all black, there's no dust cover, and there is...
hardcover, which is really nice.
Yeah, hardcover, and there's an embossed image of the, the middle portion of the Genesis Mega Drive, where it says 16-bit and the card slot and that kind of thing, a little red dot to indicate that it's on. And then on the inside cover, they have a lot of the Sega logos that we all know. Frankie, you want to come around this side, and that way...
Looks good from here.
All right. Not because I don't know if they wanted to see it. And so it starts off, I haven't really looked at this, to be honest. There's a lot of, there's some introductory stuff about the Genesis Mega Drive, and it's not a lot. And they have a lot of the, Sega-themed, artwork and...
What is the premise of the book?
The premise was they did a lot of interviews, including with a lot of the Japanese on the Japanese side. I think on the American side too, but it was basically to tell the story of the Mega Drive. Like, why did they decide to make it? How did it come about? Et cetera, et cetera.
And you get insider stories from people that work there.
Yeah. So the front of it, I think, is a bit fluff. It's kind of more of what you would see like in a just. Any video game book that describes the Genesis. I don't think there's any heavy-hitting things in there. It has a lot of the some screen caps from commercials and stuff like that. And then it also goes into the CDX, 32X, you know, et cetera. But the part that a lot of people want really to see is they get into these fold-out schematics of the Genesis and I think and pretty much everything. So here we have the Genesis Mega Drive schematic, and I think on the other side, it's like the front of it again. And that's, I guess, this, the bottom of the case. Oh, this is Genesis. That was a Mega Drive. And let's see what's next. And they have a lot of concept art. So here's like some of the early concepts for the controllers. And some additional ones there. So this is pretty cool. And I collect a lot of books that have this, like, but a lot of movies like Star Wars and Star Trek, a lot of the early conceptual art stuff that never gets anywhere. You know, a lot of times when they go back to, in those series, they wind up using it, you know, as inspiration. In fact, they're doing that with some of the newer Star Wars stuff, reusing things. It's just sketches of the Genesis again. I don't know, that's in Japanese. Now you have the Model 2 Genesis, and it has in this. I love these foldouts here, where it's these are. I guess these are. Looks like the Sega CD, like
interesting looking.
Concept. Yeah, like concept. Much more. You don't like those?
Much more different. No, yeah. I do like it. I've never seen that before.
Yeah, these are. I don't know if these have been seen before, to be honest with you, before they got a hold of them. I think this is the VR, some kind of VR headset, which obviously didn't go anywhere. As far as I know, only the Jaguar attempted that, and even that never really came out. There's the arcade stick schematic. I'll go back through this a little bit faster. This is essentially what would, you know, Sega CD, 32X, essentially what they look like as they came out. There's a Model 2 again. Then looks like a lot of color, full color pictures of the different systems, of the joysticks, the Menacer, Mega CD,
right,
Model
save
1.
Some of the book for people that might actually want
to. All right. So it's got the Sega Karaoke, etc.
Now you're only halfway through the book.
Yeah, and then there's tons of... Okay. They got all the original artwork from a lot of the games that they stuck in there. And again, a lot of this was not planned originally. It was just every time that they surpassed a goal, they were like, all right, we're throwing in another, you know...
Don't bend here.
Nah, too late. We're throwing in another 30 pages or something. So finally, if you get all this through this artwork, at the end, then they have sprite art. You know, there's just pages and pages of sprite art. A lot of it, in fact. And again, that was all added on there. And then, finally, at the end, after... I don't know what that is there. And then they get into, the interviews. So the interview section, they added on, and this is of a... You know, this is not of the same paper stock. You know, there's no reason to be. It's just, you know, text. And so they put that at the end there, and I haven't really read any of this yet, so... And it looks like if you look at it, they have the different people that they talk to, and they have their signature. You know, these are like, you know, planners. These are all Japanese. Planner, visual designer, hardware designer, director, graphic designer, et cetera, et cetera. And then there's some more artwork at the end and that they added in.
Is this book now available for purchase?
Yeah.
What is it called?
Genesis Mega Drive or Mega Drive Genesis Collected Works.
We should all look for that.
It's a little bit... the shipping's going to be a little bit more because it's coming from the UK. I don't know if, when or if they're going to be able to get like a Amazon distributor or something like that local here. I don't know. But really, really good book. And... You know, I donate to a lot of video game Kickstarter type things, and other than the Video Game History Museum, this is one of the few that have actually paid out so far to me.
Oh, you don't usually get the rewards?
No, they don't get finished.
Oh, the actual project yes. doesn't happen.
Like the retro magazine got finished, and I also did this the year two of it. But that was just a subscription. Mm-hmm. That was my reward. But I'm confident that that will be made. But a lot of the things, a lot of the, like the homebrew games and stuff like that that I do, and other some other books, which you've donated the same ones, some of them. And where are they?
It happens, yeah. You know,
yeah.
That's the pitfalls of Kickstarter. I want to glom onto that. I got something really cool. I'm glomming on. I'm actually. I have by accident the perfect bridge between yours and Mike's.
Oh, did you guys see this?
Oh, I've seen this, yes. Not in person. I've never seen this in person.
It's the 16-bit Transformer, the Megatron Transformer.
Where's the PlayStation Optimus Prime to go with it?
I couldn't afford it.
Oh, no.
There were $120 each.
Oh.
And, you know, I was like, well, I'm a big Sega guy, and Genesis is one of my favorite systems, so I figured, I'll get on board, but I couldn't do it. The other character, right, was the Optimus Prime, which was a PlayStation 1, a small white PlayStation.
Oh, the PS1.
I think.
No,
is it a PlayStation the regular, 1 the gray? Maybe it was. Yeah, I looked at them. They were both sold at exactly the same time, but this is the one I went for. And this is the company that
Big Bad Toy Store
initially was selling them. I don't know if this will be more widespread.
You can also find it at tfsource.com.
Okay.
So is this your first Transformer?
It is my first Transformer.
Welcome to the club.
Yeah, it is. But I love the fact that I guess they probably show you a picture of it. All sort of bundled up, and that's it.
It does transform into the Mega Drive.
Cartridge.
Yeah,
I was too cool to pass up.
Sure,
but yeah, I couldn't do both. So I have something else, but this bridges perfectly with what it looks like Mike brought here. So I wanted to bring that along.
And what I had,
yeah, both of you.
What I have here is my entire toy collection.
Nah, yeah.
this is the entire thing.
Lame.
Yeah,
four toys.
Yep. These are like these Soul Calibur 2 figures. Todd McFarlane had partnered up with Namco at the time. Like Spawn was a character in the game, so his toy company put together some action figures for. Here you got the Astaroth and Nightmare. They're pretty neat models, you know.
How many characters did they do? Did they do the whole line?
I don't think so. I mean, there's only five on the back. Looks like at least the monster Ivy, characters, yeah. Voldo and Necrid. Yeah. Necrid, I think, was also made by McFarlane. You know, it's they're detailed. They're pretty nice. What
are you taking them out of the box?
I haven't, mostly because I forgot I had them. I literally found them because my 6-year-old nephew found them, and he's like, "Can I have these?" I'm like, "Yeah, let me just talk about them on the podcast first." So I'll be giving these to him.
Little
6-year-old. Are those appropriate? Yeah. Are those rated for a 6-year-old, Mike?
Well, it says
they look very sharp.
It says ages 13, but I mean,
then they're not.
He's a mature 6-year-old.
I hope so. He will be.
Poke his eye out with those things. That guy's horns. You could use as a toothpick.
What's more interesting are these? These are a couple Mega Man figures, probably from 1990. Maybe the late 90s. Probably got these.
So what do we have?
Around this is a Mega Man, like a.
That's the classic
Iron Buster blue plated version from Mega Man 8, Rockman 8, and this is the X3 Hyper Special from Rockman X3. It's a gold plated armor.
You got them at Outer Limits.
I did. I bought them at this. That's
here.
What makes them, that's what makes them special because I bought them in this building.
Yeah.
Back when it was Outer Limits.
Store that was formerly a comic book and toy store, now a video game and toy store. And comic book store. Our times have changed.
You know, the thing about these, though, is that they're neat, but they fall apart. Like, you know, if I take this out, like, this one isn't bad. You know, it's got the arm cannon and, if you put these little metal balls in the cannon, you push it, like, it fires the little pellets.
You want to put your balls and push them where?
Yeah. You can put the balls in the cannon, and you can shoot them, like,
keep them
is that what they call it? Yeah. Well, yeah, a lot of Japanese toys of this
because they're like models.
More like models.
Yeah, you have to, like,
the plastic
put them together.
It's like a Gundam set.
Yeah.
This one's even worse. This one I pretty much can't keep completely together because the armor is almost too big for the frame. So like,
well, they're shiny. Yeah, it's got a nice chrome.
Yeah, the stickers are kind of coming off, but
not sure it'll be on the floor.
Yeah, it's like this piece fell
He's
off.
Missing a shoulder.
Yeah,
pack.
Like, yeah, they're all in the bag here. But I mean, yeah, no, they're nice. But this is the type. This is one reason why I don't get into buying toys because last thing I need is things falling apart. And I have to like find pieces.
If you want
to
call yourself a toy collector, you got to deal with things falling over and falling apart.
Yeah,
it's part of the being a part of.
I'm a big Mega Man fan though, so I was in high school. I came here to Outer Limits when it was Outer Limits, and I saw them, and you know, it's like that. It was one of the first times I had seen some of these more like higher quality, I guess, action figures that you call them, and. You know, because when I was little, I used to have, like, the Ghostbusters, real Ghostbusters, Ninja Turtles, and things like that. But, you know, then I saw these, and I'm like, yeah, I might buy a couple.
In Japan, they make toys for adult collectors. Mm.
And you're actually going to give those away. You're not going to hang up with them.
The Soul Calibur. No, don't give Mega Man.
No, I'm not going to give the Mega Man ones to my nephew, because... Yeah, because these are way too
even
small.
Even though he shouldn't, because he's too young.
Yeah, it's like... Because I have a 3-year-old nephew. I don't want him getting the small pieces.
No,
but
that's how you know Mike isn't the hoarding collector. That I'm very accustomed to seeing.
Reference 80.
Bring it up
wasn't
here.
Going to be, no, it's easier down here. This is
yeah, but you're not going to get picked up by the mic that well. Sure. Now move.
I'll talk from here. Okay, so. I wasn't going to bring this as my show and tell, but it was traded in over the weekend, and I wasn't here when it got traded in, so I just went down to the basement during our NAVA meeting yesterday, and while going through some other things, found this box and opened it up, and there's Commodore stuff inside. I'm like, where did this come from? And then, you know, as I'm wont to do, I tend to kind of get involved with opening them all up and looking inside of them, but this particular box really has so much cool stuff in it. It's some of it's uncommon, but most of it's just common things that, you know, any Commodore person that was really into it back then would have played or owned, but might not have kept in this good a condition or hung on to it and had it all together like this. So it was really neat. So you're greeted with Sid Meier's Pirates, which to me was the best version of this game ever. They tried doing it on consoles, but it was never quite as cool as the Commodore 64 version.
A nice book-type design.
Yeah, it has a sort of faux book style to it. It's not as impressive when you actually open it because it's just a standard sort of... Yeah, it's kind of a mess. But some of these other things kind of were.
Now, read that off there.
What? This thing? Yeah, like some of these things were kind of weird. We didn't exactly know what they were for, but your ViewTron ID and password to change your password. Type the keyword password. I don't know what this was for. There were a couple.
It may have come with a game.
It was probably one of these. So the guy, for starters, the guy that traded this in, and I wasn't here for the trade-in, so I didn't meet him. I don't exactly know, but you kind of get the profile of a person when you go through their stuff like that. It's not extremely varied in its style. It's got a lot of hardcore strategy.
Yeah, a lot of simulations.
A lot of war simulations. Yeah, this guy was really into like realistic. Style gaming. So he had a bunch of these, which I never owned any of these, but of all the ones that he had in this pile, this was the coolest one, like Carriers at War, 1941-45. It doesn't look like much on the outside. You know, it's a kind of a, looks like a folder that you might find like a press kit in. But it's actually a fold-open type game, and as you dive deeper into the packaging, as you explore it, you see just how into it these people were that made this. So they have these very glossy play aids so that they're not going to fold or get damaged when you spill your wine or beer onto it. And then, like, these flow charts for how the menu system is about to work as you go through it. Like, oh, I'm on the scenario length utility screen. I see. If I go back, I'll be back. You know, it was that complex that even the menus have their own instruction manual.
I mean, this literally, to me, looks like a Dungeon Master guide.
It does,
From the old tabletop Dungeons & Dragons era.
It's so cool. And what I was saying to Greg last night is, like, if you
if you are a World War II guy, this is one of those things you open this up and it's like splooge. So they had to sort of glossify yeah. these because this was like the ultimate for work. Look at that.
Very cool.
Yeah, like super detailed stuff. And this is just the packaging. I would imagine the game itself probably isn't very, very great. And most of these games that that were done by Avalon Hill and SSI are pretty hardcore variations on board games that they had put out. So they're not, you know, they're not action games. They're not going to excite a whole lot of video gamers. But
it's not like playing Dam Busters or Ace of Aces.
No.
They're a little bit more.
There's little to no actual action other than maybe watching a scenario play out after you've chosen your options. So they had a bunch of these types of, you know, these might have been packaged in a wide box if
I have
onto,
a,
or in a
I have
big
a,
baggy.
A view though on the World War II simulations. So if you're playing as the Allies and you lose, doesn't that feel like pretty stupid?
Yeah, well,
that you
I
lost
played a lot
the war
of those games, and I
won.
Always felt that way. Like, oh no! I've altered the course of history. Like, how can they continue the game?
I don't want to jump ahead of anything you're doing, but I'm just going to ask, does that Infocom Hitchhiker's Guide have all the feelings?
Yes.
I'm going to go through that. Absolutely. Right. Yeah, that was okay. One of the highlights. I'm not going to go through everything in here. So I already know like what has the coolest stuff in it. Now, this, I was telling Greg last night when we were discussing this, this game Elite was like a space RPG. It was an open world game where you flew, and there's some graphic pictures in here. There's not much, but just to give you an idea, like that's pretty much like the way the graphics are. It's first person. They're sort of made to look like vectors, and I guess that allowed them to have a good frame rate. But you could be a space pirate, or you could fight for the Empire, or you could be a trader where all you did was mine for gold and bring it back to other planets and try to make more money as you went back and forth. You could basically play the game any way you wanted. A massive game, really, it had so many details to the point where I remember if you flew close to the sun, it would tell you that your ship's going to overheat. But in some scenarios, that was kind of important because if you were carrying these deadly sort of tribal characters in your ship, that was the only way you could get rid of them. It would burn them all away from the ship. So the game had really a lot of detail, and it is on one disc. But the coolest thing about this era, it was the copy protection, right? Yeah. So everyone had big problems with Commodore 64 and copying discs and piracy. So they came up with this system. This is their copy protection scheme. And I so vividly remember when I saw this piece in there, you might see something like this and say, what the hell is this for? But you would load Elite, and then it would put this sort of weird barcode-looking thing on the screen for you, and you had to take this and fold it like that and put it up against your TV screen, which would give you exactly the amount of focus that you needed to see
it. Refracting it.
Yeah, and then it would refract the image so that you had the code here, and then you punch the code in, and now you can play the game. So you're legit. So without this, you can't play.
Now, what if you had a fuzzy RF connection?
I never had a problem with it. I never had great television sets back then, and I never had an issue with this. You would think that this is tantamount to all sorts of problems, right? But I guess it worked for them with the piracy, and
they probably gave up.
Yeah,
that's I've never seen that before, and my guess is probably too much money to make that piece. Versus just using like paper.
Two other things, if you go through the box here, like a lot of these, and again, Greg and I were reminiscing about these fold open type. These didn't take up a lot of space.
The record LP
and there's
style.
So many great, great games that came out in this format. Electronic Arts did them. Accolade.
Yeah, Sci-Fi Trading Company.
Yeah, right. Frankie and I think we've talked about this game on a past podcast. So there's lots of really great games. They're also, they all have their own little. Artistic value to them when you open up the packaging, but in the interest of time, one of the things that I picked up immediately when I looked at them, Ultima 1, would they have called it Ultima 1? And I think they didn't. I think what probably happened is that this
it was
a
re-release.
Yeah, at some point, probably when this one came out, because look how similar the artwork is. So by the time Ultima 4 had come out, they probably said, let's reissue the original games. It might have been harder to get back then.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think this is a super rare or expensive title, but it's just cool that it's their first Ultima by Origin on the Commodore 64 disc. And then the greatest of all, second greatest of all, the pull greatest, and when we talk about copy protection, SSI had done these gold box games, which are fairly legendary to computing people.
To RPG people, they probably may have heard this in lore, but SSI's series of Advanced Dungeons & Dragons games that were released literally in a gold-colored box are called the Gold Box Games. And they're basically turn-based, as close to the Advanced Dungeons & Dragons universe rule system and characters as possible, all packaged up into a nice little game. These were typically many, many discs with many, many accompaniments, this being no example, but I guess probably most important, other than the kind of cool little inside stuff, is this was their copy protection scheme. Almost as complicated as the Elite wheel, the Elite plastic, but in a wheel. And they did this on pretty much all of their games.
Remember to drink your Ovaltine.
You know, it was just a complex thing where you had a certain symbol in a certain place to do it, and by lining it up exactly the way it told you, you were able to play the game.
And so I can immediately recognize that, I mean, this person has save discs in his box here.
Yeah, so and to equate that, this is the equivalent of a memory card,
yeah.
And you had to have a memory card for each disc in this one. So he has each disc has its own individual memory card beyond the actual game discs themselves, of which there are four.
Wow.
So it's a pretty lengthy game. And Pool of Radiance, to me, was the best one in the series. I played all of the other ones and enjoyed them, but I don't know, maybe it was reminiscing or nostalgia, but I always liked that one the best. So, this, okay, Infocom was in a whole different level of this sort of thing. Like, they got off on doing all this extra stuff in their packaging. And this is actually a less complicated packaging routine than they had done in some cases. The suspended one, for example, kind of has a memorable... It's a very big box, and it has this mask. It's one of the characters from the game, but it's this giant mask, and then behind it was the game and all the rest of the stuff. In a more traditional version of an Infocom game, it's in a fold-open type thing like this with the manual and some, you know, little... Actually, this is a little more than just a manual. This is all this... There are various ads and stories and things that you might find in a magazine if you were in the game or in Douglas Adams' version of the game.
And this was one of the... As a fan of Douglas Adams' work and someone who grew up with Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, that trilogy of books, well, it went on to become more than a trilogy, but at the time it was a trilogy, having a huge influence on me. This was one of the first kind of... merchandise for Hitchhikers that had come along in both the UK and the United States. So it was really exciting. I had this growing up, to have the things like the peril-sensitive sunglasses and the don't panic button. But wow.
Yeah, this guy took good care of it. So yeah, here's your peril-sensitive sunglasses, just 3D glasses that have no way to see through them. This is my favorite piece in here, the microscopic space fleet. Why can't you see it? Because it's microscopic. The pocket fluff from the very early part of the game.
Cotton swab.
Yeah. Of course, an iconic part of the whole Douglas Adams universe and Hitchhiker universe, and then the games. But then, you know, they go right down to here's the actual order for destruction given on
the
4th day of October on the year of our Lord 1982 to Arthur Dent, who is the protagonist in the story. So it's really cool. It just, you know, it's
and also
not
the
Vogon
order of destruction for the planet
Earth.
Because spoiler alert, as Arthur Dent's house is being demolished, simultaneously the Earth was scheduled for being demolished.
Yeah, it's a really funny story. The game does a great job at translating it into a text version that lets you also use your imagination. And of course, Infocom just did a terrific job, as they always did. But just did a terrific job of sort of putting you in the game universe as well as just playing it.
It's this spectacular dichotomy with Infocom, because you're getting these wonderful little trinkets that come with the game that a lot of, you know, games, no other games came with stuff like this. But the games themselves were literally nothing but text. It was like playing a game in Microsoft Word, which you'd think... would be a limitation, but it really let your imagination, you know, take center stage.
Yeah, they don't even show you, you know, they don't never show you what the game looks like,
right.
Because there isn't any graphics in it.
So, in the spirit of the holidays, we're going to start off with, I don't know, just some recollections of our youth growing up around the holiday season, getting gifts. Some of us have worked in retail. Maybe we'll share some tales of retail.
Tales and tribulations.
Who wants to start? Frankie, you've probably done the most retail.
Yeah, from 97 to 2001.
Now,
at
hold
Funko
on.
Land.
Did your psychiatrist allow you to talk about this? Or,
yes.
Or has this been buried?
Well, there were people buried around the property of Willowbrook Mall, death by my hands. Towards the end of that stint at Funko Land, I really believe that if I had gone on any longer in video game retail, that there would have been a really strong chance I would have physically assaulted somebody. I was losing my mind. That's what...
You came close a couple times. I remember you telling me some stories.
Oh, yeah. I chased a kid out into the center of the mall one time, and then I just stopped and said to myself, what am I going to do if I catch him? What is the
20,
next
20
step?
To 25. Is that what you'll
yeah.
do?
But you mean you chased him out the door, outside, and instead of him running away outside, he ran into the mall?
He ran into Willowbrook Mall, and I chased him to about the center court where the fountain was at the time, which doesn't exist anymore. And I just stopped, and I was like, what am I going to do if I grab this kid? You know, even the mall security is not going to... You know, you're not allowed to restrain somebody as a store employee. You can't keep them. Even if they're shoplifting, you can't lay your hands on them. But I was, you know...
So what'd you do?
I let him just let him run.
Go. Can I piggyback on that a little bit?
Oh, yeah, sure.
There was a very similar story for me when I first opened this store.
Oh, caller.
We may have a caller.
Same person.
Caller, you are live on the Digital Press Podcast.
Hi, I'm sorry. I called a few minutes ago about the memory card for the GameCube. Can you tell me how much that is, and can you tell me if I need more than one per game?
We have memory cards of all different sizes, and they go from $8 to $25. You only need an $8 memory card.
Okay, so but it will save multiple games and multiple players, right?
Yes, it will.
Okay, great. Thank you.
You're welcome. Happy holidays.
So, and for our listeners out there, now you know that you can save more than one game on a memory card.
Except for very rare occasions, like some of the Madden games, I think, where whole season rosters are saved and they take up your card. Or glitchy games, like some of the Resident Evil ones, I think, might have problems with saving more than one. But anyway, so the story was, I had just opened the store, and I was by myself, and I was having a really bad time with shoplifting because kids were coming in here, and they knew they could take advantage, and I had a lot of live product on the wall. So as I got ever more vigilant and aggressive with the checking of kids, I had a kid who was walking around in the store with a game in his hand, and I saw him walk out with it and, like, flew into combat mode. I literally jumped over the back of this thing to get him because he was heading, like, straight out the door. Ran out the door, opened it, grabbed him by the back of his jacket, turned him around. He's holding a GameCube game in his hand. I'm like, what are you going to do with that? His mother is in the car right outside of the door, and she's like, what are you doing to my son? I'm like, he just walked out of here with the game from my store. And she goes, he wasn't stealing. He brought that game to trade in. I'm like, oh.
He didn't like your trade-in prices?
Sorry.
And he
never approached me to trade it in. It could have been that it was too busy, or he couldn't find something to trade it in for. I don't know what it was, but I hadn't thought of that possibility, that he walked in with the game, and I didn't see him walking in with the game.
You've told this story.
I probably have. I've told you. But the worst part of it was like that, other than the sinking feeling that I had just done something really wrong, was that I was waiting for the police to come up. Like, I just thought at some point during the day they're going to come up, maybe close me down. But I got away with it, and... I guess I never really chased a child down in the road again afterwards. So
yeah.
That was a lesson.
Yeah, it's all adrenaline. You know, it's that fight or flight. And then, I mean, we're logical, reasonable people at the end of the day who wouldn't do that kind of thing. And then once you do it, your brain, like, goes into this, like, it recedes, like, massively after you realize what you've done. Like, oh, God.
Hadn't thought this through all
yeah, day. Yeah, yeah. I know I've told the story on the podcast before.
I hope this is not that lady.
What's that?
I hope it's not the caller.
That just pulled up.
That just pulled up.
She wants
she
the...
she knows to come tomorrow.
But the... I'll, I'll make it as brief as possible, this version of the story. It was the Christmas of Nintendo 64 launch.
Oh, wow.
And we had a Nintendo shipping box that contained four Nintendo 64s.
I've heard this story.
And
as well.
we emptied them out, put them on the shelves for sale, and they were probably sold out by the time that this happened. We had a defective receipt printer that we put into that shipping container just because it was a great size for it, that we were shipping back to Funko Land Corporate so they would send us a new receipt printer. We had taped it up, put the UPS labels on it, put it out by the door, not on the outside of the store, but close to the exit so the UPS delivery man could pick it up. A guy pulls up in his green Cadillac or sedan, runs out into the store, grabs the Nintendo 64 shipping container that he thinks has four Nintendo 64s in it, out to his car, tears out. All the employees look at each other. We go, you know, we're going to have to call the cops about this, but it's going to be a great story. The guy's going to get home. He's going to, look what I got. And then the immediate, you know.
Would have been better if you just wrapped it right up, right into a Christmas gift. Yeah. Oh. It had the exact opposite effect of the kid who opens the real Nintendo 64 in the video. Yeah. This kid, Dad, what did you get? Why?
Well, even worse is if the kid is smart enough to see the outside of the box, but there's four four?
Yep.
My God, four? And then opens it up. And, what is this?
Yeah, and we filed a police report. We called the cops. They took a report, and they were like, "What, you know, what's the monetary value of this item?" We're like, yeah, we have no idea. Yeah. It was junk. It was garbage. It was broken. It was like a broken old printer. The monetary value of four Nintendo 64s at the time was, you know, $900 or something. It was, you know, the immediate retail day one price that people thought they were getting. Another quick Christmas Eve retail Funko story. Didn't involve any customers or any thieves. I was working at the East Brunswick location at the time, and it was Christmas Eve, and we were closing up shop. It was, I think we closed at 5, and I was going to go have dinner with my family, and my, you know, I wish my employees that were working with me a Merry Christmas, and we were going to send everybody on their merry way, and the door to the store did not have one of those kind of wingdings that you lock the door with, that you, you know, turn it. It was a keyed lock on the inside and a keyed entry on the outside, and I had my manager's key, popped it in the door, turned all the lights off, set the alarm, turned the key to lock it.
Oh, no.
The key snaps off completely, like... It must have slowly been breaking over the course of the year, and it just completely comes off clean right in the door. So I couldn't lock up the shop. I was literally trapped there until another regional manager that happened to have a copy of that key for the store. You know, like, I had to call my district manager out of his, you know, day off on Christmas Eve to come to my store and lock the door for me. I sent all of my employees home, and I stayed there for another hour. You know, I called my folks. I was like, I'm going to be late for dinner. But that was a fun...
How long did you get stuck there?
About an hour, yeah.
Like, what a day for that to happen.
It was...
Like, it couldn't happen on just random Tuesday.
Oh, Murphy's Law.
Yeah.
Always, always. Yeah, and then, I, you know, the next day, I think I had to borrow his keys to even open the store. You know, so I was like, just, you know, give me your copy of the key for this store so I can get in.
Well, wasn't the piece of the key stuck in the door?
Yeah, we managed to get it out with the pliers, but we couldn't use it. We tried our damnedest to, like, put the pliers in with the key and turn it, and it wasn't happening. But we managed to just, like, yank it out. That was a fun Christmas.
Why only one set of keys?
Because I was the only manager at the time of that location. Or the other managers, you know, had taken the week off, weren't around. I don't remember. I don't remember the specifics, but we only had one. And the DM had the other set. You guys have any good holiday stories?
Even growing up stories?
Yeah, well...
Oh,
cool gifts?
Not really when I was working retail. I worked at Blockbuster. Very little video game related stuff going on there. I mean, the holidays were always hectic. But nothing that strikes me as particularly interesting.
Never knew you worked at Blockbuster.
Yeah, I did.
How long did you do that?
About 18 months, something like that. When I was in college.
I did a couple years at Blockbuster myself.
Yeah. But this has to do with
around, it was Christmas of 1998. I had just gotten a Saturn, like a couple months prior. So the thing was already dead. You know, it was, and...
Yeah.
I sold a lot of people Saturns at Funko, like new, when they had the three games.
Yeah, that's, and I was like, that's the one.
This is a great deal.
Yeah, no, that was it. It came with the
not
three
games. 1998,
yeah.
you did
yeah.
it.
Yeah. I was surprised.
It came with the three, you know, Daytona USA, Virtual Cop, and
that was
Virtual
a year
Fighter
earlier.
Too.
Oh, okay. And then a year before, I sold a lot of them.
Yeah, it's like, so this was like, got this like August of 98. So, and the one game that I wanted for it was X-Men versus Street Fighter. That only came out in Japan. So at that point, I didn't know anything about importing. So I went looking, and I ended up getting one of those like one of those cartridges, those 4-in-1 cartridges. That
the white one?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, and I got X-Men versus Street Fighter. Enjoyed it. But, you know, after a while, I'm like, I don't have anything to play on this thing. No, there are no stores, nothing like that. And I heard somewhere down the grapevine, that Electronics Boutique was dealing in Saturn imports. And I'm thinking, well, I got this cartridge already. May as well make use of it. So I go looking. I walk into Electronics Boutique. It must have been early December, maybe mid-December. You know, crazy, crazy, you know, mall crowds. And I go up to one of the floor staff, and I ask him, you know, you do, like, Saturn imports? I heard about that. He looked at me, he's like, we don't have anything Saturn, period. Like, you know, he's like, oh, actually, wait a minute. He's like, come with me. He takes me in the back stock room, right? And
bends you over. There's a Saturn game. There's a Saturn game on the floor over there. No. It's in the corner. It's in the shadows. Just bend over and get it. Zip.
That happened after. No, but in the stock room, there was like a stack of boxes, right? Just like a stack of brown boxes. It was dark. And just sitting on one of the boxes was this, Magic Knight Ray Earth.
Magic Knight Ray Earth by Working Designs.
Yeah, it was like, I think it was like the last game that ever came out or something like that. And it was just sitting there. And he's like this. He's like,
no one will touch it.
Yeah, no,
it's been there for months.
But it was like,
but it's not the import for those that
no,
are
no.
Only
it's
listening.
Yeah, it's the American version, and it was nifty because he's like, you know, this is the only thing we got. I'm pretty sure this was like the only Saturn merchandise they had left. And he's like, it's yours if you want it. And it was neat because, you know, it's got this like embossed kind of like foil thing. So it's like in the stock room, I'm thinking like it's not. You know, I'm thinking like this. It was like kind of like an Indiana Jones kind of thing. Like you walk into this shadowy area and then like something starts shining, you know, and I'm picking it, you know, and I pick it up. I'm like, pretty neat. You know, and I just thought, you know, that was a nice memory because, you know, this guy didn't have to go out of his way to help some random kid, you know, but
there, maybe they had a bet going like who would whoever can sell that Saturn game, you know, gets $100 commission or something.
Do you remember what you paid for it?
It was expensive. I think it was like 70.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was like,
but at least that one hasn't lost its value.
Yeah.
Hey, and it took 68 blocks on that memory card, which you could actually use as a memory card.
Yeah, so right. Mm-hmm.
You got your money's worth on
it's
that.
It's a good game too.
It is. It's like a Zelda.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's actually really good.
Yeah.
But it was just a really like nice story. I feel like I think back on it like, you know what? That was like that was, you know, nice of him. It was, you know, a cool thing to do. Just, you know, here's this kid asking for this.
Which store was that?
This is the one in Willowbrook Mall. Oh. It was the one.
Rob was there.
The one where.
Maybe it was Rob.
Maybe it was me.
Yeah. It was the.
No, not 98.
Yeah. It was maybe. The old name.
Old I don't
think
Rob was there then.
Yeah.
But yeah, yeah. Well, our past podcast host and friend, Rob, he worked there too. And there were times that he would tell me that he would go into the back and sell stuff out of there. Because they would, once they ran out of room of something, they would just stack it up back there. And he's like, every. When they would do inventory, which was like rare, they'd go back there and just find be like stacks of Jaguar.
I noticed
stuff
that even with modern GameStops, when you see that back door open and I happen to catch a glimpse of what's on the walls, they have like special edition boxed games that I guess never sold overstock that are like up on wire racks on the walls in a lot of GameStop back rooms. It's like what are they doing with those things? If they put them out on the floor, you know, maybe somebody still wants that Metal Gear Solid Revengeance with the...
They just take up a lot of space.
With the lamplight in it or something.
Yeah. I don't know about your, the ones you look in, but the GameStops that I've looked in recently, they're, it's hard to even walk around.
Oh, sometimes. Yeah.
Every corner is packed with stuff.
Well, what they may be doing is their system may have, like, when, so if you buy it online, their system may go and say, all right, well, you're going to get it, but you first have to take it out of the store inventory, which in their case is their back closet, and they ship it out either directly to the customer or back to the warehouse, and then that goes to the customer.
The inner machinations.
I don't know. Maybe that's easier. Maybe it's easier for them than to return all of it back to the warehouse and have it sit there for forever. I don't know.
They have kind of a strange way of handling special editions in particular, right? Because if you look on their site, because we use their website to price our own things, you know, like we look at their price and we price our stuff a little lower, but it's always tricky when you get to collector's items, the editions of them, because they stop carrying, they stop showing them on their website after they're new. So they don't ever have used collector's editions on their site. So I've always kind of wondered, like, yeah, if you walk in there and try to trade it in, I think they just give you the same value as you would have gotten if
they,
it wasn't
the throw the extra stuff out.
Right, they don't want all the Master Chief plastic statues and the Skyrim dragon statues. And
somewhere there's a lot of those
right
up in those wire racks, many GameStop.
And I would imagine maybe at some point, you know, if it's like a game that's not hugely desirable in special edition, that they gut out maybe just the game, you know, and then they trash...
Yeah.
The big employees. Physical things that it comes with. Hmm. Who knows?
Holiday Tales.
Joe, you mentioned briefly there that you worked at a
you worked at that electronics boutique, the one in Willowbrook.
I did. I worked at it was EB when I was there. I did for what I was in the corporate world, but I was very entrenched in the video game hobby, and it was 1994 was my first year. I had gone to GameStop or at the time EB so many times that I got to get know the manager, as you know happens in all of these stores. And he was like, "Would you be interested in working here over the holidays, like just a couple hours?" I'm like, "Yeah, why not? Sounds like fun." So I did it, and it was sort of a side store to any sort of holiday thing. The best part of it for me was it was right at the time when they were starting to take trade-ins, and they had no real policy regarding how their employees could handle those. So I undercut them all the time. That's why I was there. You know, I was there. I was building my Genesis and Super Nintendo collection, and I was there specifically to get as many of those as I could. And many, many times I walked out of there with a bag load of Genesis games in the box that I either paid a little more than GameStop was going to pay, or that I just flat out said, you know, I'll buy them from you. Hello, caller. You are live on the air with the Digital Press Podcast.
Hey, this is Brett Weiss. I'm just calling in with a ColecoVision Christmas memory.
Oh, your timing is great, Brett. We're here with Frankie, Mike, Greg, and this is Joe. So you want to share a story with us about the holidays?
And wait, is this Brett Weiss, a famous video game publisher?
Yeah, please introduce yourself and your product.
Okay, yeah, this is Brett Weiss. I'm the author of the Classic Home Video Game Book Series. And my newest book is the 100 Greatest Console Video Games, 1977 through 1987, covering the greatest decade in gaming. And I've been a Digital Press member since the early 90s, and I remember getting the old videos of people's collections, and I have the early Digital Press guides, and I've been following you guys for a long time, so I appreciate the opportunity to call in.
Well, thank you for calling.
Yeah, I appreciate it. We're happy to have you.
Well, you bet.
So you said you have a story about ColecoVision.
Okay, well, growing up, we never had, I had an older brother, older sister, we never had much money. You know, we'd get $1 a week or so for allowance, and, you know, beyond that was it. If we wanted something, we had to, I was born in 1967, so the 2600 came out, and, you know, 10 years later, so I was 10 years old when it came out, and, as a 10-year-old, there's no way I was going to ask for an Atari 2600 for, Christmas or my birthday, anything else. You know, it was like $250. And our Christmases, I guess, you know, $100 was the max. And we knew that going in. So Atari 2600 was out of the question. And there's no, you know, $1 a week allowance. There's no way I'm going to be able to save up for one. And so my, you know, friends in the neighborhood, cousins, friends, you know, they started getting Atari 2600s, and then a couple of years later, then television came out, so I would get Nox, just go to everybody's house, play their game systems, you know, whenever I could, and, you know, that Odyssey 2, a couple of friends had those, two of my best friends had a Fairchild 10LF, so I would go, you know, to their house anytime I could, and just play their game systems. And that tied me over, you know, that was fine for, you know, a while, a few years. I understood that game systems were expensive, and then, you know, paying $30 and $40 worth of cartridges, that was just going to be out of question in our house. So I was I was happy just playing my friend's game consoles until 1982, when these ColecoVision commercials started showing up on TV, and they showed this amazing Donkey Kong screenshot. And I remember the ad had all these, like, spaceships and stuff flying out of the TV, and I knew that was, you know, bogus.
You wanted spaceships to fly out of your TV. You had to see the spaceships.
Do you remember that?
I do.
Yeah.
Yeah, crazy commercial, but the Donkey Kong screenshot told me. That said it all. That was all I needed to know. And I knew I had to get a ColecoVision one way or another. I was closing in on 15 by that time, but still maybe a little too young to, you know, have a real job, but I was mowing yards and such, and thought, you know, maybe I could pull off a ColecoVision for Christmas. They were $189.99 at Toys R Us. They were running, that was about what they were around Christmas of 1982. That was the big year for ColecoVision, the Christmas of 82, because I think the system came out in August of that year. And I just had to get one way or another. Well, I went ahead and asked for one, but once again, even, you know, that many years later, Christmases were still $100, and I knew that. And so I told Santa if I pitched in $100, then they could, they would pitch in $100, Santa would pitch in $100, and so I would get one. So I finally actually did get a ColecoVision for Christmas that year, but I actually had to pay for half of it, and I got that money through mowing yards and whatnot. And then so I bought a mousetrap, gave it to Santa Claus, and had him wrap it up. And so Christmas morning, opened up the ColecoVision, and it came with Donkey Kong, of course, and Mousetrap. Stayed up all night long on my blue beanbag chair in front of my gigantic 24-inch tube TV in the living room. Stayed up all night playing Mousetrap and Donkey Kong, you know, and to this day, still the greatest Christmas of all time. But, you know, I did have to pay for most of it.
So what's your favorite, without a spoiler alert here for your book, what's your favorite ColecoVision game, Brett?
Favorite ColecoVision game of all time? It's going to be a toss-up between Mr. Do and Ladybug. Ladybug is probably my favorite because it's a better port than... Mr. Do is my favorite game of all time, period. You know, arcade, Super Nintendo, and everything. But ColecoVision, it's not as good of a port on the ColecoVision as is Ladybug. And so I'd have to say, probably give the edge to Ladybug.
Both universal.
Great, amazing game. Yeah. A lot of people that have played it maybe consider it, you know, just sort of a Pac-Man knockoff or just a, you know, mediocre maze game or whatever. Mm-hmm. But that's only if they've played it maybe once or twice in the arcade and then walked away without, you know, learning all the subtle nuances of it, you know, spelling out the special extra, doing the pinball, like, you know, score multipliers and all that kind of thing. It's just a great maze game and a near-perfect court.
Ladybug is a complex beast. The Universal games had those layers to them. Once you really get deep into a game like Mr. Do and you realize that there's really more than one way to win a level, you know, and master it and rack up the extra lives and whatnot, you can really make a long game out of one quarter.
Oh, absolutely. It's an incredible game. As a matter of fact, I have a funny story about CGE. I think it was 2003. It was my first CGE. And I go in there thinking, I remember Walter Day, Billy Mitchell, they were doing a big high score championship contest and all that. They had several games picked out. And one of them was Mr. Do. And leading up to that CGE, I had practiced Mr. Do quite a bit on my ColecoVision, thinking that would transfer pretty well to the arcade. I'd played it in arcade, but a lot more on my Coleco. And thinking, you know, I had a legitimate chance of, you know, getting a high score or winning the competition or whatever. And so I bugged Walter throughout the day, when's the Mr. Do contest, when's the Mr. Do contest, because he kept saying, oh, it'll be real soon. Well, when I finally got a chance to play Mr. Do, I got completely destroyed by this guy that had these just really intricate patterns that I'd never seen before, where he was building, like, all these stair steps within the grass maze, making apples, you know, like five, six, seven apples fall on one, you know, or making an apple fall on several, you know, five or six monsters at once, you know, just doing all this stuff, racked up well over a million points. I walked away with my tail between my legs, completely got destroyed, but it was fun, seeing how good he was at it.
Well, thanks for sharing your ColecoVision memories, and we have a lot of fond memories of ColecoVision here on the Digital Press Podcast, so we'll catch you next time. Thanks for calling in.
You bet. Appreciate it.
Thanks a lot, Brad.
Thank you.
Oh, you bet. Sorry if I rambled on a little bit, but thanks for letting me call in.
Nope. Happy to have you.
No problem at all. Happy holidays.
All right, you too. Take care.
See ya.
You should have gotten his book.
Cool. Well, yeah, we can now mention his book, and we can put an HTML link up there for it, and everyone can kind of see what Brett's got. Yeah, we just got them in stock here, and we were looking it over yesterday, and he's very brave. He's a very brave author. You know, a lot of people take the easy route when they're going to do a top 100. They pick the top selling games, or they take the top games that they think people will want to hear are the best, but he's very, very bold in his choices. And he has it's a limited time period. It's 77 to 87, right? So it's just
10 years.
It's a slice of time. But there's a lot of games in those time and that during that time. And he's got some pretty bold choices.
Yeah,
so
you will find a very non-traditional ordering of games in his list.
I was really happy when I opened it up.
And this is like his, I don't know, his fourth or fifth book in the same vein. But the previous ones, I think, they weren't, clearly they were... you know, his first attempt. So this one is like the first like full on book that I could tell where it's hardcover and there's a lot of pictures and it's all color, et cetera, et cetera. It's in Barnes and Noble. I believe most Barnes and Nobles have it. I mean, I don't know if they all have it, but then most of them have it. There's like a small, like a little section, like literally on the side of one of the shelves, which says like for the video gamer and your family or something like that, and his book is there, you know, as well as all these other modern game guides and stuff that I could care less about.
Good. I hope he does well.
I miss the era where you could learn everything about beating every video game in one paperback with large print. How to win at video games.
By Jeff Rovin. It's always Jeff Rovin on those early books.
And it's like, page one, Pac-Man, eat all the dots. Page two, Space Invaders, kill all the aliens.
Go this way.
Yeah.
And Pac-Man.
So, Greg, you've been quiet in our holiday discussions.
Well, I won't give a retail experience, because I don't really recall much Christmas specific. It was mostly
all the drugs?
No, it was just mostly stressful and annoying and boring.
Did you ever work retail?
And annoying, yeah, for a little while, and just et cetera, all year. So the holidays really doesn't stand out to me any more than any other time, other than I hated it. A lot. So anyway,
Tell us what you think, Ebenezer.
I don't have an issue with that. It's just I just hated retail. Like, we could talk about July. Hated it. March. Hated it.
Yeah, I would say of the four of us here, you would probably be voted least likely to have worked in retail.
No, not well.
Enjoyed it. Not that you're grouchy, but you're a little grouchy. Look at the way you're sitting.
Yeah, no, I was not.
Furrowed brow.
No, I was not cut out for that. I would say it's more, I have a couple of stories. One of them is goofy. I think this was probably around 92, maybe. The Genesis had been out, but for most people, nobody cared or heard about the Genesis before Sonic. That was, at least in my world. Like, Sonic came out and we're like, all right, this is a serious...
You were in the wrong
system
world.
Here.
Really? So wasn't popular Genesis until Sonic came along? Were you like in your neighborhood?
Nobody had one person. I think had one.
Now, how old were you in 1992? Just so I can kind of.
I think I was 14.
Oh, all right. I always forget we have quite an age difference.
Yeah. I was eight.
Huh?
I was eight.
Yeah. That's great. I think I was 30.
No, hold on a second. I knew about. Yeah, but I knew about it for 92. Obviously.
I was 28.
No, I was 9.
We were, 9, you know what it was? Everybody that I knew, we, like as kids, we were all Nintendo. It was NES, NES, NES. So we all had Nintendo Power magazine. We all did Nintendo this and this. So we never even would have heard of Sega. So it just wasn't in, like, so the only way we would have seen something like that, because nobody got, like, EGM or anything like that then. We're kids. So the only thing we would have known was when you started seeing it in, like, flyers for, like, toy stores and stuff like that, and Sunday paper or in your mail, or if you just happened to see it in a toy store, or so, maybe, like, some kid, this older kid had it on the block or something. But then usually I was too young, they wouldn't let me in their house. Like, get out of here, you loser. And so,
wait, can you bother me?
Anyway, so this was Christmas, and I already had the Genesis. I think I had it for about a year and a half. And I brought it to my grandparents' house because one of my younger cousins was getting it for Christmas. But, as I recall, I don't remember if he got it that morning at his own house or something, but etc. So they told me in advance, hey, why don't you bring the Genesis and play it, whatever, all right. So I bring it with me, and he was going to get a game. And this, he and his father, they're all giant hockey fans, like huge hockey fans. And they decided to get him, one of my aunts or something was getting him a hockey game. So he was so excited all day because he had this Genesis, and he, you know, it's still at home. He wasn't able to open it or whatever. He was going to have stuck playing mine. And so I forget, we were playing like some of the games that I had, you know, Sonic and whatever, Madden Football. And so finally, you know, it was turned, let's open the gifts. And he opened it up, and it was a hockey game. But it wasn't, like, I don't even know if NHL was out by that point. I don't think it was.
NHL PA 93?
Was that the first? No, the first NHL was maybe 92. So it may have been out. It was probably out.
Probably.
So he didn't get that. I don't know what other options were. He didn't get, like, hit the ice or anything like that. He got Mario Lemieux hockey.
Wow.
Which was not just a bad hockey game or a bad sports game. It was simply just a terrible video game. And I remember him, I forget how old, I was 14. He was probably like 9. Something like that. Yeah, probably like 9. And I remember him playing the game. We played it for about 20 minutes. And afterwards, he was just like, he started getting really angry and then cried. For like another 2 hours. Because, you know, he was so looking forward to this hockey game, and it was a pile of crap.
I remember one Christmas, not to digress too much, but my parents asked me, you know, I had a Nintendo Entertainment System, so it was in that maybe 97, around that time, and they asked me if I wanted a game for Christmas. And I had seen advertisements at the time for the Uncanny X-Men game.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
Wait, 87 or 97?
I'm 87. So 87.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Not 97. That would have been Super Nintendo era. But 87. And I had seen advertisements in comic books and magazines for an Uncanny X-Men game by LJN.
Which
should have been a, you know,
should have
red flag at the time. But
no way.
We weren't there yet. We weren't. We hadn't.
You knew back then LJN was a problem? No.
I don't know if it's specific. No, that's what he means. We didn't specifically
know.
It
that's
just happened to be every single game.
It wasn't a red flag yet. It wasn't really a red flag yet. I mean, it was kind of reaching that critical mass.
In hindsight.
At that point in time. In hindsight.
It was a red flag.
I do remember, though, that games that were advertised on the back of comic books routinely were pretty bad.
Okay. Yeah.
I do remember making that association.
So I did, you know.
Because I was suckered in a couple times.
That went on my Christmas list, that game. And I recall them telling me they had really difficult time finding it at retail, even though it was being advertised as released in comics
and
a couple game magazines. And I don't know if it was because it's sold out in places, or if it just wasn't. LJN didn't publish a lot of copies of it because they knew it was, you know, a steaming pile of garbage. But they got it, they found it, they may have had to special order it at like at a location that could do that, that could get it factory direct from LJN. And they were like, "Oh, you know, we went through all this trouble to get it. We hope you enjoy it." And I was really excited because it was really the first, outside of a couple games for early PC and Commodore 64. Yeah. It was one of the first comic book, you know, games featuring the X-Men. And I got it at Christmas morning, opened it up, put it in, and if there was a I wish there was a time lapse photo of my face, my mood going.
It's like
the stages of excited,
the grief
to you know, putting
bewildered,
it in and playing it.
Angry video game nerd face.
Yeah, and then
you ever seen, it's like those
faking the happiness for a couple minutes. Like this has to get better. Like, this game has to improve at some point. To me, getting. Reaching that moment of depression, like
it's like the charts at the hospital.
Yeah,
what's your tolerance? How much pain do you feel?
Yeah, it's going like, from 1 to 10. Yeah. Yeah, so I had the Mario Lemieux hockey moment with the X-Men for Nintendo.
Let me ask you something about Mario Lemieux hockey. Do you remember if he had the box with the puck in it?
No, definitely not. I don't think so.
That's but honestly, I don't have that.
Well, I'm sure he doesn't have it now.
No, but I'm just saying.
That, really?
It was a little collector's note for you all and everyone out there in hockey land.
There was a puck that came with the game?
Yeah, it came in an oversized box, and the standard retail game was inside, and then there was a puck outside of it sitting in all within a cardboard outer shell where you could see the puck.
Neat.
And it was a Wayne Gretzky signed puck.
Like very
for Mario Lemieux?
Mario Lemieux signed puck. Yeah, that was, like a fake. And I have the puck. And I have the game loose, but that cardboard box that it was in is very hard to find.
Like so many things, I can almost guarantee you that we got one of those traded in at Funko, and we wound up smacking the puck around the floor and throwing, seeing how much force need to be exerted to break a hockey puck.
The puck's a real puck.
Yeah.
It's not a replica puck.
No,
it's a good hockey puck, but it's the box. That's
I'm
probably
sure
very
we
fragile.
Destroyed.
To be honest, he may well have gotten it in with the puck.
I'm not sure even if they all came that way or not. But they're very hard.
I just know it was a bad game. It was not a good game. And it's funny because I never really had that experience at Christmas because at Christmas I was always very very prepared. I was always well researched. Very rarely did I ask for something that turned out to be garbage. Because it was very rarely what I've said, oh, this game just came out like, you know, 2 weeks before Christmas. I want this. Because it never came to that. My mom would ask me like in September, what do you want? And you must tell me within like 2 weeks or you're not getting it.
What were your methods for research? Because at the time, most game magazines were, you know, blowing smoke up Nintendo's ass every year. You couldn't find a bad review for anything.
I probably would have either have played the game at a friend's or rented it.
Rented it.
Because like I said, it was nothing brand. I never, rarely got a game back then that was like brand spanking new. Unless it was like one of the Mario games or Zelda. Then I'd be like, oh, I must have this. But
Mario Lemieux?
No, not that Mario. Mario.
How about Wayne Gretzky?
I think Wayne Gretzky hockey was decent, but that was on Super Nintendo.
N64. There were a couple of them on there.
But yeah, so I was usually much better prepared for Christmas than my birthday, which was in the summer, where I made a lot of unbelievably stupid, impulsive purchases of video games, usually spurned on by a friend who I was like in the Toys R Us with, and he'd be like, oh, this game looks the best, why don't you get this? And I'd be like, oh, okay, yeah, the back of the card hanging there on the wall does look good. This looks like a good game, I will get this.
I was a sucker like that too.
Airwolf, this looks great.
Like,
it's my favorite
like I was
NBC
the,
show.
Like I was the, you know, like,
you can beat Ernest Borgnine.
I was the angel. I was like the marketing firm's like patron saint.
Dope.
You know, like if you had a nice like ad or something like that, or like a nice like mascot type character or something like that. Like,
you were the kid on the front of those late 70s, early 80s video game boxes with the controller.
Yes.
Like,
yes.
Which, you know what? We need to make, maybe in your empty notepad there, we can make a note that we're, that we should talk about the ads.
Mm-hmm.
The ones that lured us in and the ones that we remember. Sure. And it would be a good future topic. Because I've got bells going off all over now.
One last really quick story. This was in like, this was probably like 88. Because I think I got the NES that summer. And one of my aunts was asking me what I want for Christmas. And I said I wanted a Nintendo game. And they're like, well, which one do you want? I said Metroid. I really wanted Metroid, and Metroid obviously was out for like 2 years, so it wasn't new. And it just so happened they waited too long. Unlike my mother, who bought everything in October, they waited too long, and it was like nowhere. And so, like, the funny thing was, my mom had to, like, because my aunts, they really didn't want to, like, go crazy with that kind of stuff. So my mom had to, like, drive all over the place looking for this game for me, for one of my aunts giving it to me, which made no sense. And we wound up at this, in our hometown, this awful, awful video game store slash rental place, which should rot in hell. And that guy was selling it for, like, $70.
Jeez.
And they
what was it called? Was it Broadway Video?
No, it was Video Game Dynasty.
Video Game Dynasty.
That was the worst store I've ever been in.
Where was that?
It's in Belleville.
The Dynasty ended there.
Basically the guy was, he was horrible, and his girlfriend, they were both really, really nasty, and they rented video games and movies and the whole nine yards, but their prices were obscene, and they would only carry like one copy of a game.
Well, they were probably paying like full retail. They probably didn't have a distributor where they could get, price. And what was the margin at that time on video games? If you weren't like a KB Toys or a Toys R Us, the distribution systems probably were not giving you any breaks for mom and pop shops.
Did they buy the $70 game and give it to you for Christmas?
Yeah, because my aunt was paying. My aunt and uncle were paying for it. So
you still have that Metroid?
Yeah. Yeah, I kept the NES. I kept everything I ever got for it.
Was it in the box?
No, I didn't keep it. My mom. That was the other thing, was my mom bought everything in October, and I'm not kidding you. Within half an hour of me opening all the gifts, I had to make sure I took everything out of the boxes that I needed, because those boxes went in the trash.
Just curious if that had, at least has a happy ending, because a boxed Metroid is probably, it's not worth $70, but it will be. It's not far from it.
It doesn't matter to me. Yeah. I still have my Metroid.
But maybe they wouldn't have to rot in hell if your $70 Metroid is
still... No, that store should still... That store should still rot in hell. Definitely. Just for how nasty they were.
Do you guys have any, standout single titles that you got for Christmas or holidays that, your favorite... became one of your favorite games of all time, or...
I got the Super Nintendo on Christmas morning. That was fun. That was nice.
That's great.
Yeah. It was, it was just...
Did you know you were getting it, though?
I never really knew what I was... I was like seven, 8 years old. And, I asked for it, but, my parents never hinted one way or the other. It was always like...
Were your parents really cryptic about... Like,
they would always
say, it's a little expensive. Yeah.
No, they would, people they would ask me, or they would have like other people ask me to,
are you asking Santa for Christmas? My stranger would come up to you on the street that your parents had paid off. Hey kid, what do you want for Christmas?
So should I tell you how I got the Super Nintendo? Yeah.
Like my auntie would put the Sears catalog in front of me and said circle what you want, things like that.
The Sears wish store.
Yeah. So I was saying before, I had the Genesis in like 91. I got that for my birthday, and I was I liked it, don't get me wrong, but I was still a Nintendo fanboy. So at some point, some of my friends at Genesis, some had Super Nintendo, and I kind of got sick of hearing of the raving about the Super Nintendo and the games from like all of 92. And I was like, I want this thing now. And then I remember seeing Mario Kart in Toys R Us and playing it for an hour, just going berserk. So I'm like, I got to get this somehow. So my mom was like, no, you're not getting another video game. You just got one, a year and a half ago. So I used the sister angle.
Yeah.
I convinced my sister to ask over and over again for that she wanted the Super Nintendo also. So it became like a dual gift. So I connived my way into getting the Super
Nintendo.
That worked?
Yeah, it
did work.
I'm sure my sister, maybe listening to this, is laughing her ass off. That would never have happened in our house.
Wow. Did she play video games, though?
No. I was twisting her arm to get her to do it.
Yeah.
Other than the ColecoVision, I think the only game system that my folks bought for me, because as I've said on the podcast before, after Atari 2600 and Coleco, my parents were like, if you want a game system from here on out, you earn the money yourself, you get it, you know, if you're that interested in it. And they knew I was and was motivated. So I bought an NES for myself. I bought a Super Nintendo for myself at various points in time. I think the only system post-Coleco that I got for Christmas from my parents was the original Game Boy at launch. You know, and that was interesting to them, too. Like, they, you know, had never seen anything like that. So that sparked in my parents, like, a little, like, oh, well, we know we've written off game systems, but this is something different, you know, with the Tetris included and everything. That was a good one. I fondly remember that Game Boy that year.
So, yeah, so, no, it did work. But what didn't work was that we still only had one TV to play, like, four systems on, and so that was a bit of a brawl.
Did you daisy chain all of the RF connectors together?
No, I just used the one.
Just the one.
Well, it worked on everything except the 2600.
Yeah, I don't have stories like that. I was eight in the crash of 83. I was 18 already. So most of these game systems that came out that kids remember getting when they were, you know, when they were kids for Christmas, I was already an adult buying them with my own money. But the Atari systems and the eras prior to the crash, the Pongs and that second generation of systems, even those I had to buy with my own money. That was just a deal in our house, you know. My parents were like, you want an Atari? Work for it. Buy it yourself. Get your own TV, too. Because I've told this story a million times, but they would not allow me to have any sort of game system on their television set because they saw my cousin's Pong TV and the Pong that was always on the TV, even when the TV
it's
was
like burned
off.
In.
That's what my parents remembered about video games all the way until, you know, I had my own.
Yep.
So I don't have those. I got Rock'em Sock'em Robots for Christmas one year. It was awesome because I didn't get it the year before, and that finally Christmas came along and it was there. I was victorious.
It's still fun. Classic, it's still fun. My nephew has it.
So we good? This is a pretty long segment. Yeah, it went longer than
this
I expected.
This might be the bulk of the episode.
Okay. Very good. All right. Onward.